Today we're going to talk about how to install the TMC2226 with UART on the Bigtree Tech SKR version 1.4. So I need to talk about a couple of things, and the first thing is our stepper driver. So as you can see right here, I have a stepper driver, and let me zoom in a little bit more. So in the bottom left-hand corner, we have our enable pin. That's kind of relevant for our setup. But as you can see, there's not a lot on top except for the one to its left that does have cooling fins. This will allow the heat to be wicked away during its time of its duty cycle. So what I need to show you is first we need to figure out on our actual steppers where they're connected. So we have our X stepper right here, then we have our Y stepper, our Z stepper, our E0 stepper, and our E1 stepper. So we need to figure out what our pin configuration for the jumpers are. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to bring up the web browser and show you on the actual manual for this. So the Bigtree Tech SKR version 1.4 has a manual on how to configure things. So I'm going to scroll down to where it has the steppers and show you the configuration. So as you can see, this is step dir. This would be something like your A4988 or your DRB8825, where they cover all the jumpers on these pins. In our case, we're using UART for our communication. So I need to find it right here. So as you can see, there's our configuration with our jumper pin. So we're going to be doing sensorless homing, so we don't need to clip a pin. We'll be able to do our X homing with our stepper driver. So to do that, I'm going to go back over to the workbench and show you how to set this up. So I'm going to pull out these pins or these jumpers so that I can get them in the correct configuration. So once they're all out, I'll actually place them in a configuration that we can then use. Sorry, this one's taking a little bit longer than normal. There we go. So the jumper pin that we saw was actually right over here. So we're gonna push that down. And that's the correct configuration for the jumper. So to place this in place, we're going to notice that the actual coloring gives it away. So there's black on one side and then there's red on the other with the pins. So we're just going to place it in here and apply a little bit of thumb pressure to get it into place. So there we go. Next, what we need to do is set up our motor. So I'm going to connect it over here. And then I'm going to connect the USB power in a moment, but first I'm going to connect direct power to this. So as you can see right here, I actually have two wires from our power supply. This is actually a 12 volt power supply. So these ferrule connectors will keep the wiring in place, and it's a safety feature that allows you not to damage your board. You'll also notice that I created a safety feature here for myself where I mark it with a red on the screw for that particular one so that I match the colors correctly. So that's the actual voltage. So I'm going to slide these in to their little containers, and then I'm going to tighten them down. Once these are tight, I'm then going to connect the power for the USB, which will not power it because our jumper right now is in the VCC, which is direct power. So I'm going to connect this up, and then I'm going to actually plug it in and do what's known as a smoke test to make sure that I did it correctly, and hopefully we won't see any smoke. So it looks like everything's good. So what we're going to do is we're going to go over to the computer and see what happened. And one of the things that we need to check on very first off in the order is the actual setup that we have for our USB drive that's on our SKR. as you can see, the actual file that exists right now is firmware.cur in all capital letters. That means a firmware was recently loaded successfully because it renamed itself to cur. So we're going to go over to VS Code. And inside VS Code, we're going to click on the Explorer. Then we're going to go to Open Folder. Then we're going to go to our Downloads folder, our first Marlin, then our second Marlin, and then we're going to say Select Folder. And this will open up the Marlin environment that we're working with. Inside here, we have to configure our board. So I'm going to go to the Marlin folder, then the Source folder, then I'm going to go to the Core folder, then boards.h. Inside boards.h, I'm going to search on SKR_14. And what that'll do is it'll actually bring us to our SKR version. So there's two versions of the 1.4 board. There's one for the LPC-1768, and there's one for the LPC-1769, which is the turbo version. And in this case, I have the turbo version that I'm showing you on. So I'm going to copy this, and then I'm going to close out a core and source and go to configuration.h. Inside configuration.h, I'm going to search on motherboard, and I'm going to highlight the RAMPS board here, which is the default configuration, and paste our configuration. Up here, I'm going to actually change the serial port to -1, which will allow us to communicate with our board. And then I'm going to search on the A4988, which will bring us to our stepper for the X, and I'll remove the comment. Next, I'm going to search for our board, which is right here, which is the TMC. Well, actually, it's not exactly here, but it's the 2226. So it could be this one, or it could be another one. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to use the 2209 for the moment, but it may be specified as this one. I still have to research that. So I'm going to paste it over here, and that'll allow us to use it as a UART configured TMC 2209 for the moment. Further on down here, we do have to keep an eye on this, and I'll show you why in a second, because we're going to go over to the Advanced tab, and we're going to search on 800, and it may be a couple of searches before you get to it, and you can see that there's a 16 for microsteps. So these equate together, so 1 being 80, if you change to 160, would then be 32 for here. If we were to change this to 320, then this would change to 64. And if this changes to 640, then we're going to change this to 128. And if it changes to, let's see, 1280, then this would change over here to 256. That's how it works. So the other thing we need to do is configure debug. So I'm going to do a search on TMC_debug. And I'm going to remove the comment over here so that it'll enable us to use these debug codes, because we're interested in the M122. So we're going to find the other one just to make sure that we have it enabled, which is right here. It's TMC debug. So I'm going to remove the comment, and then I'm going to go back up for a second. And what I want to do is search on sensorless homing. So I'm going to do sensorless, and this will bring us to sensorless homing capabilities. So I'm going to remove the comment, and then over here they have the TMC 2209. That's the configuration for sensorless homing between 0 and 255 for sensitivity. In this case, I'm going to do 125. That should give us the right sensitivity or approximate therein. So we're all set with that. So there's one last thing I want to show you, and that's if your homing is going in the wrong direction, you can search on invert. And down here, if it's going the wrong direction, you can always change it from false to true. But for now, I'm just going to leave it alone so you can see how it works. So to set up the actual compile, I'm going to click on platformio.ini. And right now you can see the default environment is set to the Mega 2560 chipset, which is for the RAMs. But we're actually using the LPC1769. And that's for the turbo. So I'll show you that real quick again. Over here in this category, this is actually what we're looking for. So we're going to copy that. And then we're going to close out of boards.h. And we're actually going to place that in our platform IO default environment. So I'll paste it right there. Now, the first thing I like to do is actually a clean, which is this little garbage can. And that gets some of the previous builds out of the way because some people, like myself, actually do a lot of building. So once that's been cleaned, I'm actually going to click the upload button and see what happens. And what will happen is it should compile or build all the micro compiles and then place the firmware.bin on our drive. So let's see what happens. Now this on this computer actually will occur somewhat faster than most due to the chipset that I'm using for the computer. But as you can see, I had a failure. So one of the things I can do is I can look over here and see that there's an error for Wi-Fi. I'm not using Wi-Fi, so this might be that there was something that was occurring before. So I'm doing another clean, and then I'll do a build again. This sometimes happens when you do a build. If you see it multiple times, go to the first error that you see and then see what that is related to. If that doesn't work, sometimes it's better just to download a new firmware, extract it, and then reconfigure it. But you should always keep a copy of what you last configured so that you can compare it to your previous results or past results. So as you can see, it actually did compile in about 25 seconds. So let's go over and see what it looks like over here. So you can see that it says firmware.bin. So that's the file it's going to load and turn into this. So one thing you can do to confirm it is actually just delete this file. And if it's successful, it will turn into that. So let's go over to the desktop for a moment. And I'm going to unplug the board. We're going to give that a second to discharge. Then we're going to plug it back in. And it should load the firmware for us. So what we can do to check this is actually go over to our USB drive, which I'll bring up in just a second. And we can confirm what we see. So over here you can see that firmware.cur is now the current load that just took place. So what we're going to do next is we're actually going to go to the workbench for a second, and I'm going to actually use Pronterface as a way to test this. So I'm going to click on Pronterface, and inside Pronterface, we're going to see that right now it says COM port 1. Now, as you can see, it also says that there's a COM port 13. In this case, I know it's the COM port, but the way that you can confirm that is to do this. You can go over to Device Manager, and I'll bring this up so you can see it. And inside Device Manager, you can click on your ports, and you'll see that your COM port is 13. So I'm going to close that, select the dropdown for that, and connect. Now you can see that it's connecting, and the printer is now online. So we can test our actual stepper to see if it's functional by doing M122 as a G code. And as you can see, it says that it's okay. So what we're gonna do next is we're actually going to test this. So first I'm gonna move it 10 and it moves. Now let's try homing. Now this might go in the wrong direction, but this has to do with the inverting that I spoke of earlier. So I'll click on that. And as you can see, it homes perfectly fine. So we can move it 100 millimeters, then 200, and then we can home it. So if you like my tutorial, please press the like button and subscribe. And by the way, no one is paying me or sponsoring me to do this tutorial, but I will place Amazon affiliate links in the description for your convenience. So take care and have a nice day.